So thank you, and now we have another communication in the same way, same spirit, is Professor Sonia Armand that we're very happy to have here. And the title that she gave is Becoming Humans, the Legacy of Toolmaking, just what we were talking about, 3.3 million years old. Sonia, very welcome.
Thank you, Professor Coppens. Thank you for the invitation and also to give me the opportunity to meet with you for the first time. Sounds very incredible, but yes, it's the first time we meet. Thank you also for the Pontifical Academy of Sciences to open such discussion and debate about this important topic. As Zahai showed in his presentation, biological evolution is not the only part of our evolution, and we need to really consider behavioral evolution. Behavioral evolution is what is also going to make who we are. So saying that, I'm very happy to be here because we don't have here in this room a lot of archaeologists today. We are only two, and I think inviting the archaeologists to the discussion about human evolution is very important. So the irony, I would say, with the discovery from Zahai and his team and the discovery of my team is that Zahai has the cut marks, but not the tools, and I have the tools, but not the cut marks. So my title here is very ambitious. Now that I'm reading it, I'm like, yeah, it's going to be hard to talk about legacy, but I'm going to describe to you the stone tools that we found on the west side of Lake Turkana that are for now, so far, the oldest found, not saying that older ones can't be discovered, and I'm hoping they will, but so far they are the oldest one. So this discovery has been made by my team, a West Turkana archaeological project. I put a nice picture here of the team and all the sponsors to thank everybody right now. So I'm going to talk on behalf, of course, of the West Turkana archaeological project. So Lake Turkana is located in Kenya. Sorry, Michel, we talk about East Africa again. So Kenya, west of the Lake Turkana, where the arrow is, an important region around the lake, well known for discovery of very famous fossils, but also a very important region for archaeological sites. And when I say that, I mean for both sides of the lake, the west side and the east side. I'm going to talk about the west side of the lake today, where we work. And this is a map of the west shore of the lake. It's a bit small, but you can see that there are a couple of archaeological sites here in white that range from 700,000 years old for the most recent one to 3.3 million years old for the one in red. So basically, we know that hominins have been making stone tools in this area for a very, very long time, which make this region very important for us. So Zahai talked about using tools, and I think it's a very important notion I would like to insist on right now. There is a huge difference between using something natural and making something. Using something, it could be taking, collecting a flake, something cutting in the environment, stone, of course, if we talk about the Pliocene, and use the edge. It means that already there is a notion of the efficiency of an edge. What I'm going to talk about is the first evidence of making. So this arrow saying shift, in fact, it's not something I'm going to talk about because we have no idea, as I said, what happened between using and making, basically for now, with the evidence we have, between 3.39 and 3.3 million years old. But as you can see, we are very close in time. So I'm going to talk about making tools because it's basically what we have found on the west side of the lake, published in Nature in 2015. And you see here on the cover of Nature, two of these stone tools. I know they look ugly, they don't necessarily look like something we would imagine could have been the first stone tools, and especially here on this cover, you don't have any flakes, which are normally the most known or important type of artifacts that we discover, because flakes are the stones that we are going to use, that the hominins are going to use. What you see here is a core that I hold in my hand and an anvil, and I'll come back to that later. So I'm not going to take too much time talking about what, why is it important for what, why it was important for hominins to found, to make or use stone tools, because it has been said also by Zarai, of course it enhanced the function of teeth. Basically, Kuntik tools are artificial teeth. It allowed access to diversity of food, high nutrient, and you can use tools for cutting meat, plants, for smashing and get access to the marrow. In that case, we are not using flakes, and we'll talk about that later, for grinding, and also later on for protecting. This has been also mentioned. We are not the only one tool users. And Brigitte talked about capuchins. Zahai talked also about capuchin and chimpanzees, and basically not only non-human primates are using tools, but we also know dolphins and sea otters and a lot of birds, especially New Caledonian crows, are also able to use a tool. But again, we are in the using, or we could say we are in the modification of a natural form, but we are not in a creation of a form. Only humans use tools in almost a limited and ever complex ways, and only human can create a shape. And as Professor Roche was saying also earlier, making a tool from a stone is very much more complicated than just removing some small leaf from a stick. So for a long time, the only evidence of tool making was what was found at several Old Dawn sites in East Africa, but also in South Africa. And these sites were, for the oldest one, dated to 2.6 million years old. With Lomekwi 3, we have a game-changing discovery for several reasons, and show you a map here of where Lomekwi is situated. Dated at 3.3 with the classic stratigraphic correlation with tuffet we know in the area. And so it's a game-changing discovery because of its antiquity. So we pushed back 700,000 years the beginning of tool making. So 3.3 million years old now, when with the older one we had the earliest evidence at 2.6. And this is where we created a new culture called the Lomekwian. We consider these stone tools we found at Lomekwi are very, very different from the one, from the older one, and I will also come back to that later. Game-changing discovery also because we have the evidence that this antiquity show that probably, for now, Homo was not the tool maker, because we don't have any Homo at 3.3. And also a game-changing discovery because of the type of the tools we found. So we found flakes, but we also found a lot of pending tools. And we also found out that the techniques to make these flakes were different, or at least for some of them, different from what we see during the older one later on. So now for the early Stone Age, we have three different cultures, Lomekri, 3.3, older one, starting at 2.6, and the Acheulean starting around 1.76. I would like to make a remark right now, is that we have a lot of older one sites. We have a lot of Acheulean sites everywhere in the world, but we have only one Lomekri site. Only Lomekri 3. So creating a culture, an entire culture based only on one site, I know it's a bit pushy, but we did it for several reasons. I also can't talk too much about it today, but we might have found some other localities at Lomekri that could at least enrich a bit the list of sites we have for the Lomekrian. So don't throw me the stone, okay? Yes, Lomekri is only one site, but there is a Lomekrian culture. So I'm going to talk a little bit about the discovery, how we found them, how they look like, how they were made, which is my specialty, how they were used. Don't be too excited. We don't really know yet. And I'm going to talk about the potential candidate for this early toolmakers. So that's a map, a close-up of the location of Lomekri 3, an area that is well-known because of Kenyanthropus platyops, which has been found there by Mivliki and her team, and published in 2001. And in fact, there had been no archaeological survey in this region of Lomekri when we started to survey there. There had been a lot of work, a lot of survey for fossils, but no survey at all with archaeologists. So we found the site in a classic way, surveying, looking on the ground with a lot of people, walking in line and looking at every single stones or every single bones we could find, flagging them and trying to find concentration. We were not, of course, expecting to find a site at 3.3 million years old, but we were certainly not expecting to find this kind of tools. So I would say that what is important when you survey in the Pliocene is to have no cliché. Okay, you have to look for things without any mental images of what they can be. So that's a picture of the survey in 2011, so this is the kind of landscape we are dealing with, very similar to a lot of landscape in Ethiopia. You see here the site in the middle with this blue tarp on it. It's the excavation in 2014, and what you could see at the horizon is, in fact, the lake, Jokana. We don't see it very well here. So as you can see, the site is difficult to excavate because the level is situated under 3 meters of sediment, very, very impacted, very hard sediment. You can have an idea here with the excavation of the depth of the section. But of course, the first stone tools we found were on the surface. Otherwise, we would have not been able to see them. Okay, so the person with the white t-shirt on the left basically is located where we found the first stone tools that were eroding from the surface. Now, when you see the rest of the people toward the section, it's where we can follow the archaeological layer and where we found a lot of our tools. So that's also now a picture of the excavation at the end of last summer. So we have now 10 by 6 meter excavation, a bit of surface collection, of course, and again, a more than 3 meter deep section. I didn't say that we are, of course, still excavating at Lomekwe 3. We are still finding some stone tools there. So how do they look like? They look like things we were not expecting, again. We uncovered nearly everything that hominin used to make the tools. What you have here on this picture are a couple of cores and fragments in situ, while they are still on the sediment. That's the uncover of one of the core, and you can remark right away the size, the dimension of this core. The tools I'm going to describe are huge. So that's the one of the last core that we excavated. All of the materials are volcanic rocks, different kind of volcanic rocks, but all of them are volcanics. They have been collected by the hominins locally. So we have evidence of conglomerates around the site that could have been contemporaneous to the site where the hominins were collecting their raw materials. So basically they didn't have to go very far to find their raw material, which you understand also when you look at the dimension and the weight of these stone tools or the core, these are not things that you can transport very far. The blocks have been selected because they were large and heavy, so it's something that we were able to show. The hominins had the possibility to select smaller raw materials, but they systematically went for the largest and the heaviest one. So they selected their morphologies and their dimensions, and they also selected the raw material. We have also found flakes. So you have two pictures of flakes being excavated on top, and again, more cores and fragments, the two pictures below. We have found anvils, so very large, very heavy. Two of them are very difficult to move. Even for us, it has been difficult to remove them. More picture here of a core, and down below, flake. So I always have the question, how do you know they were napped? How do you know they were flaked? Because they look natural to me. It's something I usually have. So I'm not going to give a lecture about how we know stone tool, the stones we found are stone tools or not, but I would like just to give you a very small synthesis of the kind of criteria that we're looking for. For first of all, the raw materials, they need to be suitable for tool making, of course. Then presence or absence, and position of conchoidal fracture, which is this fracture that is typical of material that have been napped. Then we look at patterns on the cores, if they are repeated, if they are organized, if we have traces of impacts. All these things are things we can see on cores. And of course, the context of find is very important. We are not paying too much attention when we have one or two flakes on the surface. We can't really do anything with that because it could be completely natural. So it's not one thing, one single trait that we look at to identify stone tools. It's an assemblage of criteria. And we have very specific criteria to validate a rock as an artifact. So that's a flake. We don't have a lot of flakes yet, which is a bit surprising because we have a lot of cores, but again, we are still excavating the site. They are very fresh for the age. Some of them you could still cut with them. This shows you the preservation and the non-disturbance of the site. So when I was saying the cores are very large, very heavy, I call them also the mega cores. You have mean dimension there. This industry, the Lomequian, is much larger than anything we know, especially the older one, but is also much larger if we consider the flakes than what non-human primates are producing accidentally. So we spend a lot of time looking at the technology. No need to say that it was a bit disturbing to start with, to study this kind of material, because we had never really looked, of course, at this kind of tools. So we were five different archaeologists, experts in tool analysis, looking at them, sometimes disagreeing, most of the time agreeing on the marks that we could see on the cores and flakes. What I could say is that we are here at 3.3 million years old, probably not in presence of the first stone tools made. Why I'm saying that? Because we have already a kind of sophistication. So what do we have? We have, first of all, cores that are very heavily flaked. Well, very relative compared to the older one, of course. But still, we don't have only one or two flakes removed from a pebble. So we are not in the what was called the pebble core technology. We already are dealing with people who were able to remove a lot of flakes from their cores and rotate the cores in order to exploit the cores a bit more. We also have a lot of percussion marks on these cores, which was surprising. Normally, a core is made to produce flakes, but we also have percussion marks on the cores. These percussion marks, for now, under study, and we have a paper in PrEP showing that most of them are the result of napping activities, not for bone marrow or nuts. Okay, so this is also something I would like to say today, is that it's not because you see percussion marks on something, on a stone, that you can think that this stone has been used, for example, to break open bones to have access to marrow. And I'm going to explain why we have these percussion marks on the cores, and why I'm saying that they were these cores were made to produce flakes and not to process other materials. So we have multi-purpose tools. They serve as cores or percussor or anvils, which is also something we don't see very often in the later time period. Earlier time period, sorry. So I'm not going to describe that too much. It's also a paper in PrEP about to be out, showing that the exploitation phases of some of the cores we have at Lomequi III are complex. They have a history, the different techniques used. So when I was talking about techniques earlier, and you're going to see here the relation with the percussion marks we have on some of our cores, we found out that the techniques used at Lomequi III to produce the flakes are also different from the main one we know from the older one, so from the earlier time period. Hominins 3.3 million years ago at Lomequi III used two techniques, one called the bipolar technique, where you have the core resting on an anvil and be hit from the top with a hammer stone, and the impact is going to create sharp flakes. That's the first one we have. The second technique we had identified is the passive, where you directly strike your core on an anvil. Very straightforward, very easy. We don't see any evidence or marks of freehand percussion technique, which is the technique dominant for the older one, where this time you hold the core in one hand and you hit the core with a hammer stone. So the percussion mark that we see on some of our cores, if I leave this slide for you, in fact, can be explained because the cores were used as anvils at one point. Okay, and so, hence the percussion marks on cores. So these flicking techniques, we identified them in replicating the kind of napping we have at Lomequi 3. So on the right, you have the experimental replication. On the left, you have the archaeological object. And we could identify comparable criteria when we use passive and when we use bipolar. I have to add that because the cores are huge, you can imagine that using the freehand percussion techniques, holding one of these cores in your hand and hitting it to produce flick is probably not the most clever thing to do. So resting the cores on an anvil or using the cores with two hands on an anvil to produce flicks is what we have at Lomequi 3. So again, in that sense, in terms of technique, in terms of dimension of cores, dimension of flex, we are very, very different than what we observe during the older one, and I would insist also during the early older one, 2.6 million years old. Function, now that we've seen how flex were produced and how tools were used, function of these early tools, well, we don't know yet. So we have conducted a couple of residue analysis, and you have here my colleague, Nicholas Taylor, and myself, taking from the sediment a couple of tools that could have potential residue. So far, this analysis gave nothing. We are not surprised. 3.3 million years old. This would have been another cover for Nature, probably. But you have to try. You have to do it. So we don't know yet. What we know, though, is that some of the tools were used as anvils to create bow flex. But we have no direct evidence that the flex were used on meat or any other material. Even looking at microstriation, microware, that's a difficult thing to say. The raw material, being also volcanic and medium grain, doesn't help with this kind of study. A couple of remarks. We know that roots and tubers, nuts, termite, you know, any kind of insect were probably part of the diet of the hominin during the Pliocene. You don't need to make tools to have access to these resources. And yes, evidence of slicing, like Zara showed, 3.39 with cut marks, but no stone tools, but evidence of slicing, evidence of cutting for meat. So we have multitask tools, again, cores, heavy cores that have been used for pounding or have been used as anvils. And we have also this same material, the same tools used to produce flakes. So we found one refit at Lomequi 3. So a refit is when you're able to position the flake that you see on top onto the core and reconstruct the original shape of the raw material that had been exploited. So far we have only one refit. It's an important one because it showed us percussion marks also on the flakes, meaning that this core has been used first as an anvil and then napped to produce flakes. So we have, thanks to this refit, the order of the processes. And we found this flake on the surface, among the surface collection material the first year, and we found the core in situ. So always good to have this to show that at least part of the material we have on the surface was in situ and belonged to the same site. A couple of bones, very well preserved. I'm not going to insist too much on that. We're looking for cut marks, of course, right now. A couple of different animals, nothing crazy for the area, nothing particular. Paleoenvironment, isotope analysis have shown that we are in a more woody environment than what we can see at Gona, for example. So not something that is forest, of course, but something that is with trees and probably open areas. I would like to say a couple of things about the candidates, the potential candidate for toolmaking at Lomekwe 3. We conducted a series of experiments, specially testing different grips, and we concluded, also a paper in PrEP, that if you need hand motor control to produce flex at Lomekwe 3, you don't necessarily need the precision grip or thumb opposability. Okay, because these two techniques, when I'm talking about the passive techniques, basically, you can still hold the core roughly between your hand, and you don't necessarily need to have the thumb to hold the core. So possible toolmakers, I don't have the answer, but we have Kenyanthropus platyops very, very close by. A kilometer away for the holotype, and we have some teeth attributed to platyops also very close to the site. Afarensis was around, not geographically, but chronologically, and the same thing for the Eurymeda. So, a diversity of hominin possible to makers. Burning questions. I would love for paleoanthropologists to find more hands for this mid-Pliocene hominins and endocast, if possible, to understand the manipulative or prehensile abilities of this hominin. The experiment we conducted, of course, are conducted with Homo sapiens, so always a bias. Another burning question, of course, is improve the stone tool evidence, understand what's happened between before Lomekwe 3, so before 3.3, and trying to reduce the gap, for example, between Dikika and Lomekwe, understand a bit more the origin of tool making, what at what moment made us hominins shifting from using something natural to making. So we are also looking for sites that are younger than 3.3. We have no site in the Natuquay Formation west of the Lake Turkana between 3.3 and 2.3. So we have a 1 million-year gap. We know they are there. We just need to go back and look for them. And of course, we are also searching for older deposits. I put Miocene here as a bit of a provocation. But it would be great to find stone objects with traces of percussion, but not only. Dikika showing us that it's possible that flake production was very important at the beginning. So I would conclude saying that Lomekwean pushed us also to revise this nice story of Homo habilis making stone tools. We are now dealing with a time period where we can say that we can no longer consider only Homo as a tool maker, but we have to consider Australopithecus or Kenyanthropus or the two or more. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Well, Homo, Australopithecus, Kenyanthropus, or somebody else. So,